We're a band of Christian soldiers fighting Satan every day. We're standing up for Jesus while we're kneeling down to pray. If his precious blood has cleansed you and washed away your sin, that makes you a member of the blood wash band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood wash band. I've been washed by the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. I was bound by chains of sin till one day the Master came and made me a member of the blood wash band. God's children are advancing, marching till we reach the goal. Lord, the battle's almost over, we'll soon be going home. I can hear the angels singing as the saints go marching in, singing praises to the captain of the blood wash band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood wash band. I've been washed by the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. I was bound by chains of sin till one day the Master came and made me a member of the blood washed band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood washed band. I've been washed by the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. I was bound by chains of sin till one day the Master came and made me a member of the blood washed band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood washed band.
Only as clean as the blood of Jesus can make me. Go beat that one. Hallelujah. All agree? Praise you, Jesus. For those who are interested in politics, very interesting stuff happening as the news is tightening on the Democrats. And somehow Biden's legs seem to be giving out on him. I think they should take him to an old folks' home already. While Trump's golfing is improving, it seems like, for those of you who saw that. Anyways, I don't think it's much of a joke the way they torment that old guy. But that's what he sowed. You shall reap what you sow. Throughout his life, he's been trying to get into the presidency. Now, when his brains are given out on him, he finally made it. That reminds me of late. Remember that NDP guy? He was down, and finally he started going up, almost coming to be the second party in Canada. And guess what? God says, finished. Your work is finished. Bye. So, is your work finished? Are we still working? Well, I tell you what, we are heading for an interesting time. Either the rapture or the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which will change everything, because otherwise we're going to be plunged into a dark period in this planet. And when I study the Word of God, I believe the Word of God teaches that we are heading for a turnaround in this country and in the world. If you look through the history of the world's situations, they've been under the domain of Satan since almost the beginning, about 300 years after Jesus was crucified, or 400, the world was plunged into darkness through religion. We've had some interesting revivals breaking out periodically. And I believe now we're in the time of the end harvest. So we're going to see what's going to happen. Either way, it's exciting. If Jesus should come today, are we ready? I am. How ready am I? As ready as the blood of Jesus can make me. That's an interesting way of putting it. Don't try to argue with guys how good you are, because nobody's good, but the blood of Jesus made you clean and holy. There's a difference, hallelujah. So we are ready if we're made clean and holy through the precious blood of Jesus. And when we watch what's happening to the unbeliever, the Bible teaches us something that I was struggling with for years, but I'm beginning to understand it. That in the end, there's going to be gross darkness. And we're starting to see that happening. You know why? Because the gray is taken out of the way. You either are for Satan or you are for God. So if you're for Satan, it's gross darkness. They're into demonic worship. They're into pedophilia. You watch and pay attention to some of the laws those people tried to pass, allowing pedophiles to go free with a slap on the wrist. And on you watch, and you're wondering, what on earth is God doing? You know what he's doing? He's just showing us right now what he's seen for years. We were asleep. We had a nice little party of Christianity, going to church on Sunday and doing our thing. But now God is putting back the curtain and we're looking at a horrifying situation. Unbelievable wickedness in this world. And it's not only in the government, in those places, it's also in the churches. Terrible wickedness, pedophilia, selling human beings. I was listening to a preacher the other day, or I don't know if it was a preacher, but there's a place in Vancouver called the Meat Shop, where they sell babies for $300,000. And what does the government do about it? Oh, they pretend they don't know about it, but it's there. What are they doing with those babies? They are peddling them to the highest bidder for sexual pleasure, for baby parts that they need, for their blood. It's not a conspiracy theory anymore because it's hitting the news. Isn't it strange when it's on Facebook, it's a conspiracy theory? But as soon as Fox News or CJOB will never report it, but Fox News reports it every now and then, and there goes the conspiracy theory. Now we can believe it. I like Fox News lately. It seems like it's an open hunting season on the Democrat Party. Some of those guys are pretty vicious, and I'm enjoying it, hallelujah. But you know what? You still feel a little compassion for those poor idiots who have rejected God and have thrown them out the window and are following Satan because they've been blinded by the enemy because of their own foolishness. They do not follow after God. They do not seek after God. And Satan kicks them at will through deception, through pleasure, through the lusts of the flesh. And by the time they wake up, it's too late. They're caught in the trap of Satan and they can't wiggle anymore. So what is God going to do? He gives them over to a reprobate mind. What's a reprobate mind? A mind that God is not influencing anymore. A mind that thinks what the person thinks and what Satan influences him with. God is not putting that check there anymore. So he's out and finished for the eternities. God says, I am not mocked. Whatsoever you sow, you shall also reap. So today we're going to get into an interesting message. Are you on the foundation? And how do you build on that foundation? This can be very interesting. and you check your own heart. But before we get into it, let's rise and ask the Lord for blessing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace, Lord. You will open our hearts to your truth. Help us to understand and believe what the Word says. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen. You may be seated. Not too long ago, I read this little clip when somebody was preaching on the side, and that little clip said, there's a lot of Christians today that believe the Bible is only for salvation. The rest is just for good reading. Check your heart out. Are you for that? Is that your attitude? Well, today I'm going to teach on an interesting subject that will determine, if you're honest with yourself, whether you truly believe or not. Because I have a pretty good testimony by a guy that I've listened to throughout the years, and he kind of opened my eyes to how he thought years ago and what it took to change his mind. You know, when you study people, eventually God gets a hold of them. And then things change. If you pray for somebody, if you pray for your child or for somebody, you don't pray for God to protect them. There's a way to pray for your kids. And I found it out very early in life. I said, Lord, if my kids don't behave, use the hammer if you have to. Hey, what's a little pain? At least they'll be saved in the end. That's how you pray for your loved ones, because they're closest to your heart. You don't want to pet them all the way to hell. You want them out of there. So you give them over to God and say, whatever the consequences are, Lord, you know best how to deal with them. And guess what? God will always come through, because he sees your heart, he knows what you want, and he's gonna honor it. But if you're going to have this lovey-dovey, maybe iffy love for your loved ones, then his hands are tied sometimes. And then it tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 10, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, another built thereon, but let every man take heed how he builds thereon. See, this is what the church has lost. We're supposed to work together. One lays the foundation, the other builds thereon. We shouldn't get into each other's way by getting into competition. We work for the same goal. And that is to bring people into the kingdom of God. Can you imagine a football game where they start fighting each other? What would the score be? We know how that would work out. But guess what? That's how the church has been operating for the last, I don't know how many hundreds of years, fighting and completely at odds with one another just because of different ideas, of different doctrines. God shows somebody a doctrine or a revelation, and he starts teaching it, and the other guy over there, who doesn't have a clue what he's talking about, comes against him and tells him he's wrong. No, wait a little bit. Maybe God will open your eyes. If you truly study the Bible, if you truly want to know the truth, I want to share something with you. Even your own revelations that you had years ago will change a little bit. They'll take on more meaning. They'll take on more meat. They'll broaden out a little farther than they were. That's how it's supposed to work, because God is dealing with something that is eternal. And it's not put in a little box. It can spread out. So it tells us this foundation is laid. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, for other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon that foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or stubble, the choice is yours. How do you build upon that foundation? But the main thing is, make sure you own the foundation. What is the foundation? It's Jesus Christ. It's not a religious system. You have to be on that foundation. That's where the safety is. Then you can build on it, whether you use wood, hay, or stubble, or gold, silver, precious stones. That's your choice. You're going to either win or you're going to lose. But your salvation is secure as long as you're on the foundation. So, are you on that foundation? There's many people listening through the internet. When you go on YouTube, you can clearly see the foundation they have is flawed. There's something wrong. They don't believe in the finished work of the cross. They have to add something to it. That's why I say I'm as clean and as holy as the blood of Jesus can make me. Try to beat that one. You can't, because that's what the Bible teaches. And it does that for us. Without that, you will not see God. That's it. That's how it is. We cannot get around that one. I don't care how religious you are. I don't care what clothes you wear, what religious rules you follow. If you're not on that foundation, everything is useless in the end. So make sure you're on that foundation. But once you're on that foundation, then determine what you're going to use to build upon that foundation. Wood, hay, stubble, or silver, precious stones. The difference is here, we're going to be judged at the Bema Seat of Christ, the judgment seat of Christ, not for our sin. Our sins are taken care of at the cross. We're going to be judged for what we used to build upon the foundation. And if you do not use what God offers, and you use your own material, then you may have a problem. What is the problem? The problem is this. God wants to give you crowns. He wants to put you over cities. He wants to put you over countries. He wants to put you over universes. But if you're going to use your own material, then sorry, you will lose your crown. That's what the Bible teaches. It tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 13, every man's work will be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. So, I love the way the Apostle Paul puts it. I cannot judge myself. And he wasn't talking about his salvation. He was talking about his work for God. It's God that's going to judge me. That's why he tells us in Philippians chapter 3, let's press towards the prize, the mark, the high calling of God. And all those who are perfect, let's have that mindset. Not to try to get as close to the sin as we possibly can, but to walk in holiness and do the will of God. Your works will be revealed. It'll be by fire. But it tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 14, if any man's work abide which he built thereon, he shall receive a reward. But if any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. He shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. I love that last little scripture. That's my salvation. At least I'm in heaven. Hallelujah. I'm going to heaven by the grace of God through the blood of Christ. But the building I'm building here on this earth depends on what material I'm using. Do I have my own little kingdom? What is my purpose in life? My purpose in life since I've become a Christian has been one thing, and that is to bring the lost to Jesus and to set the captives free. Many, many, many Christians are tied hand and foot by Satan, and they need to be set free through teaching, through casting out demons sometimes, through letting them know that Jesus loves them. Do you know how many Christians don't really believe that Jesus loves them? He loves them with a heart that'll never, ever fail. He loves them more than you can imagine. That's what brings me through. If I fail, if I feel down and out, if my wife has an argument with me and she wins the battle, I can say, Jesus, at least you love me. Hallelujah. Isn't that awesome? That's the way it's supposed to work. And then I go on my way singing, hallelujah, Jesus is Lord. You know, if you believe that, if you study that, if you see the heart of God, you can always be assured, regardless what hits you in the face, Jesus is there to pick you up because he loves you. He paid for you. You're his purchased possession. But I want to do more than that. I want to please him. I want to stand there with my head up high. Yes, I know I'm not going to be perfect. Yes, I know I have flaws, even in my work for God. And it's God that's going to judge it. But at least I want to try. I was reading this testimony of this preacher who got cancer. And he had a pretty big ministry going. And he said, Lord, it seems like I'm going to die. But I want to live longer. I want to do my ministry yet. Like Hezekiah in the Bible, you give him 15 more years. How many of you know if Hezekiah would have taken God's advice, he would have died and the world would have been better for it? Why? Because Manasseh, his son, the biggest devil that ever lived, was born. And the Bible teaches because of the sins of Manasseh, he couldn't forgive Israel. Isn't that interesting? But in the end, Manasseh even turned back to the Lord. So there's even a grace for those who are the worst. It's because of the sins of Manasseh that God could not forgive Israel. When you study it, you see the plan of God always is best. And it was this pastor, he said, Lord, like Hezekiah, give me a few more years. I want to do more with my ministry. I'm right at the top of it now. Just give me a few more years. And then God gave him a vision, or he died, or whatever happened. Anyways, God saw he was in the throne room of God. And God said to him, you really want to continue your ministry? You want 15 or whatever years more? Yes, because I'm doing good. And God said, okay, I'll show you something. He took back the curtain, and all the man did was build his own little kingdom. Isn't that interesting? He built his own little kingdom. Here he thought he was working for God, but what he was working for himself. His own ego was driving his ministry. And God showed it to him. The guy repented, and he did get healed. And guess what? He had a different attitude after that one. So how many of us are like that? Yes, we want to serve God. What is your purpose in this life? What is your next step in this life? Do you want to honor God? You need to seek him out. I can't tell you what to do, and I will not. That is your problem with your God. I can give you advice, and I don't even know if my advice would fit what God has for you. So you have to figure it out yourself, have a relationship with him, and God will make sure that you're on the right track. So if you build on that foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, you will receive rewards. If you don't, if you build with your own thing, wood, hair, stubble, then you will lose whatever God had for you, but you yourself will be saved, which is good enough for me, hallelujah. But I still covet to have crowns, and I still want to be over something when God says the final word. And the reason is this, because I want to please him, because he is the one that wants to give it to me. So God is telling us, build with gold, silver, and precious stones. You may be safe, but you can give it more. You can give it more. So where are you? Where are we? In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 6, it tells us this. How should we work it? I have planted, Apollos has watered, but God has given the increase. We can preach as much as we want to. I've been on the radio for the last 20 years. I've preached to many, many, many people. How many have come to know the Lord? Here a few, there a few. Why? Because God gave the increase. That's where it's all about. You can talk yourself blue in the face. If God does not give the increase, then nothing will happen. It says, but God gives the increase. So then neither is he that planted anything, that bring you down a notch, neither he that watereth, but God that gives the increase. Now he that planted and he that watereth are one. We're working together, we're on one team, and every man will receive his own reward according to his own labor. So don't look at the other fellow, don't judge him. Make sure you're right in your heart when it comes to God, because the great judge will one day judge you, and there's not going to be anybody besides you but yourself, and he will make sure that it's righteously judged. I saw a scripture that says, I will not judge according to what I see. I will not judge according to what I hear. I will judge according to what I know. And God knows everything. Hallelujah. So even if you're slick, you're not going to be able to get past God, because he knows everything. So, for we are, in 1 Corinthians, for in chapter 3, verse 9, for we are laborers together with who? God. Isn't that awesome? We are working together with him. All you have to do is figure out how he works, and then things will start to happen. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. And that's what he wants to do, is to build his body through his way. For we are laborers together with him. God wants to use us. He wants to bring us to himself. If we do not have a heart for God, then he can't. If we do not have a heart for other people, he can't use us. The main thing is to have compassion for Jesus. Once you have that compassion and that love, then it'll spread out to your fellow man. That's how it works. It doesn't work the other way. It works the way you love Jesus, and then his love pours into you, out to other people. I was listening to an interesting person called Dutch Sheets. How many of you know that guy? He's been around forever, and he's been a very solid teacher in my book. But years ago, he said, something happened to him. There was a big earthquake in Guatemala. How many of you know where that is? That's South America somewhere. Never been there. And it had destroyed a lot of buildings amongst the tribes of Indians that were there. And they were there building them buildings. And as they were going from village to village, telling them, the reason we're building those buildings for you is because Jesus loves you. We represent that love. And on the last village they came to, they were preaching and building those houses. And the last village they came to, the people didn't pay much attention to them. Yes, they They were very attentive, but they didn't turn to Christ. And then just at the last day, his team were walking in the village. They found a little girl, 7 years old, tied to a tree, just like a dog. And when he said that, I knew exactly what direction that was going. And he said, they asked the father and mother of that house, why do you tie your child to that tree? Oh, that child is crazy. If we would let her go, she'd hurt herself. She'd run away. We couldn't be able to find her. She hurts other people. So they told this to Dutch Sheets, and it was his turn to do the last service. So he started preaching, and the Holy Spirit said, you are going to set that girl free. What? He never experienced anything like that. Oh, I would have loved to be there. What? I have never heard of that. You are going to set that girl free. Is there a plan B? Yes. It's called disobedience, and it's called death. That's plan B. The child is going to be dead, and you're going to be disobedient. Well, how do I do it? You just do as the Word of God teaches. And he told the people, we are going to set that girl free. He said, I was scared. And I tell you, I do understand. First time you tackle a demon, there's anxiety there. And he walked over and he said, here's what he said. The Jesus of yesteryear came out of history and stepped into today. The Jesus that had the cobwebs all over him brushed himself off and stepped right into the situation. The Jesus of yesteryear that was put back by the church for so long all of a sudden became real and powerful, and that girl was set free through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the Jesus we serve. And guess what? Hallelujah. You can give him a hand clap. He does. I've seen it. And guess what? That whole village turned to Jesus. This is how it works. If people see the power of God, yes, you can preach Jesus. Yes, you can say by faith. But in today's society especially, and in places where the power of Satan is so real, they can tangibly feel it and operate in it, they need the power of Jesus. It has to be more than faith. It has to be the power manifesting. And here is what I see for this world, for North America. We are in a dark place. I don't believe I've seen North America so dark as I see it today. God revealing the pedophilia. God revealing the terrible corruption that's going on, not only in the governments, but also in the churches. There's only one thing that can help, and that is God stepping on the scene. And I firmly believe in my heart that's what's going to happen. Within the next couple of years, I believe we're going to see a turnaround that's going to shake the world. How is it going to happen? Through God pouring out the latter rains. Yes, those who don't want God, they'll become darker. But those who want God, they will see the light. We've preached the gospel to thousands of people. Yes, we've planted, we've plowed, we have talked to them. But one day God will give the increase. Look at how Jesus preached for 3 years. He preached the gospel, he preached his word. Nobody came. But once God spoke to them, once the Holy Spirit came down and touched these people, they cried out, what shall we do? What was Peter's answer? Turn to this Messiah. He loves you. and he's going to save you if you trust in him for salvation. It wasn't done through just preaching. It was done through Jesus, the power of the Holy Ghost, giving the word of God and implanting it into those people's hearts and opening their minds. Yes, when you talk to a blind man, you take them to that wall over there and tell him that wall is black. Eventually, he'll believe you and say, okay, that wall is black. And guess what? He will never know the difference until he sees with his physical eyes that that wall isn't black. And this is how it works with God. People don't quite believe it if they don't see it. But when God opens their mind, their eyes, then they say, how come you never told me? Well, I've been telling you, I was blue in the face. But now the one that's really loves you, he has given the increase. He has opened your eyes and your mind, and nobody will take it from you. But now you have a choice. Do I want it or don't I want it? That's the critical moment. When God opens your eyes, you have to say yes for it to be of value to you. So open your heart to this. Become a blessing to those around you. Tell them about the awesome God that we serve, and we're going to enjoy eternity much more. Hallelujah.
I just love that good old gospel singing.
I'll fly away is my favorite song.
I just love that good old time religion.
This old world has gone without it much too long. Oh, how I golden bells, and I just can't stand in one place when they sing Amazing Grace.
I just love that good old country preaching.
This whole world has gone without it much too long.
Good old country preaching.